Hi, Randy Cantrell here, Leaning Toward Wisdom, leaningtowardwisdom.com. That's the website. Coming to you from the Yellow Studio in Dallas-Fort Worth, Texas. And I hope this is going to be the first of three videos, all designed about what I believe are at least three steps. I'm going to keep it simple and limit it to three. Three steps to being remarkable. I realize not everybody wants to be remarkable, and I realize some people, they would like to be remarkable, but they're not willing to pay the price for it. I was rereading some things. Howard Gardner is one of those bright minds that when he speaks, when he writes, I listen. And many years ago, about 22, 23 years ago, I recall reading some things that he had written about creativity, and he's gone on to be, you know, a very renowned scholarly mind when it comes to creativity and innovation and learning cognitive skills. But he wrote this about creativity. He said, "It's a serious business for serious people. Creative work requires, I think, being a certain kind of person, which includes being able to work on things for years, a drive not likely to come to people who paid $500 for a weekend under a tent." Prior to that quote, he had said that one of the main points about creativity would be to disabuse people of the nonsense that you see advertised. And he went on to talk about these advertisements for a weekend retreat, some workshop. Give us $500 and we'll teach you how to brainstorm, and we'll teach you how to free associate, and we'll make you a creative person. And I kept thinking about that phrase, disabusing the nonsense. And I believe that is step one. I believe that is step one to you and I doing our dead level best to try to work toward being remarkable. Now, there's a few things about being remarkable. Number one, it's not for everybody. Well, it may be for everybody, but everybody's not going to pay the price. Not everybody's going to devote themselves to it. If they did, then everybody would be remarkable, and, well, there you have it. Now it becomes average because it's what most everybody does. The fact is, being remarkable is not what most everybody does. The fact is, most of us are average. Most people in education, most people in every endeavor in life are average. Do they have to be? No. No. But most people just make up their mind that that's good enough. They're not interested in devoting themselves to any greater effort, any greater concentration. I believe that Mr. Gardner is right, that there are things, creativity among them, that likely require greater effort, likely require greater concentration and focus than just a single weekend. And I suspect he's also right in this notion of disabusing the nonsense. There's lots of nonsense in the world. Here, the website, well, the title tells you everything, Leaning Toward Wisdom. It is the goal. It's the objective. And I rather think that nonsense permeates so many different facets of our life. It permeates the world of business. It permeates sports. It permeates religion, investing, entertainment, writing, public speaking, music, education. Now, Mr. Gardner asserts this thing about creativity, to disabuse the nonsense when it comes to how people think about creativity, creative work. But I think it's true in nearly any area of life. And one of the most ironic areas that you could apply it to would be stand-up comedy. Now, I've never been a stand-up comedian. I don't have the chops for that. But we've seen documentaries. We've even seen movies. We've seen depictions of the struggling stand-up comic. And quite often what we see are we see stories of private despair, even depression. It's tough work. It's really tough work. One could even say it's very serious work. And it demands serious dedication. I mean, come on. How else could you explain somebody's ability to go to some comedy club where people might not be the most receptive people on the planet? They're busy drinking and visiting and doing whatever it is people do in such places. You've got to get up there. You're going to subject yourself to possible ridicule, possible rejection. You're certainly going to subject yourself to long hours and low pay. And you may subject yourself to that for a good little while. I did a video, I think it was a video, over at BulaNetwork.com about those years that the Beatles spent in Hamburg, Germany, kind of honing their chops, playing their tunes, writing, playing, writing, playing, writing, playing, writing. I mean, hour after hour after hour after hour, day after day after day after day, 7 days a week for a number of years. Serious work done by some serious guys, all before we ever knew who they were. One of the biggest components, I think, of nonsense is the nonsense that, well, he or she, they got where they got. They're lucky. They got lucky. There's little doubt that there are some people who got lucky. But by and large, when you look at successful people, you're going to find that it usually doesn't happen overnight. You're going to find that usually they weren't lucky, or it's going to be like it was a golfer. I'm not a golfer. Otherwise, I would know who said it. The more I practice, the luckier I get. I think there's that component of luck. Some would call it serendipity. You can call it whatever you want. I do believe that we can put ourselves in a position for success. Now, I'm not a big believer in the law of attraction and all that kind of mumbo jumbo, The Secret. Those are marketing ploys. Those are ideas born in the mind of a marketer because people want to believe that kind of stuff. Well, that's nonsense. That's nonsense. It's nonsense to think that a few $100 or even a few $1,000 will provide for you this easy solution, this easy button that, well, we're all looking for it. And what it does is it puts a few $100 or it puts a few $1,000 into the pocket of a marketer who's being more successful at your expense. Now, I'm not saying that ideas are not sometimes worth paying for. I'm not saying that help and assistance is sometimes worth paying for. It may be. But more often than not, what I believe is the missing ingredient to improvement is summarized with three simple steps. And what I want to do today is talk with you about the first of those. They're really easy, I think, to understand. They're easy for us to get our mind wrapped around them. The difficult thing is to fully embrace them so that we do them. The hard part is always in the doing. But the first of these is rid yourself of false assumptions and the nonsense that stands in your way of being remarkable. There's no way that you can embark on a remarkable career in education. I don't care what your role is, unless you first get rid of the beliefs that hold you back. And some of the beliefs are just, they're sheer nonsense. But you don't think so. If you did, you wouldn't have them. You and I have these beliefs, and sometimes these beliefs are very deep-seated, and who knows where they come from. We draw all kinds of assumptions. based in part to how we were raised and the environment that we were raised, based in part to all the information that we take into our minds. There are people today in the political scene, for instance, who think that anything that comes from Fox News is a load of garbage. But anything that comes from CNN is the gospel truth. And there are people who hold just the opposite position. If it comes from CNN, it's garbage. And if it comes from Fox News, you can bank on it. Well, truth be told, you know, there's a bit of garbage on both. And there's a bit of truth in both. And there's a bit of bias, maybe a lot of bias on both. But we get these false assumptions and they permeate, like I said, they permeate every industry. Some in the field of education, just like any other field, some are very widespread. Others aren't. But this much is true. The delusions and the nonsense that can permeate education, we're not united in our delusions. We're not united in our beliefs in the nonsense. If we were, then, well, you'd have a little bit more peace. Now, the fact is, sometimes there's great conflict in the field of education. Sometimes there's emotional conflict, and that conflict stems from the fact that somebody believes something to be true, and somebody else believes that that's completely wrong, and they believe something else is true. Now, it could be that one or both of them are wrong. It could be that they both have got it wrong, but they believe they're right. Not long ago, I was privileged enough to see Danny Hill and Jason Nave do their presentation. These are fellows that have written a book, and if you've not bought the book, you should go to their website and purchase it. They co-authored a book some years ago called The Power of ICU, and ICU stands for what you would think, intensive care unit. It's a very practical, powerful tool that a school can use to hold students accountable. I happen to strongly believe in their message, and I strongly believe in, I believe in the practice that they have put forth in the book. But Danny starts his presentation addressing the nonsense that can cripple a teacher, the nonsense that can cripple a school campus, and he uses an illustration that is Plato's allegory of the cave. If you don't know what that is, I'll put a link in the blog post or the show notes to this video over at the website. But it's very true, and it's a very powerful allegory. We really only have to give ourselves, I think, a little bit of quiet time to recall some instances where it dawned on us, you know, we had it wrong. We had it wrong. Now, only a fool would say, that's never happened to me. Well, that's happened to all of us. Maybe it happened. Have you ever met somebody for the first time and you sized them up and you thought, man, they're pretty cocky. They're pretty conceited. It could be just a very casual, rapid interaction, but we think we've got them sized up. And then some other occasion happens later, and we're put in a position where we can spend some time with this person, really get to know them, and we realize, man, we were way wrong. I mean, that first impression that we got of them is not at all who we now believe they are. They're quiet, they're reserved, they're kind of funny, maybe they're dry-witted. But we mistook some of those things in our initial interaction with these people, that initial meeting, we mistook those signs to be conceit and arrogance, and they weren't at all. We had it wrong. Sure, I dare say most of us have experienced something like that, where we thought we had it right. We were convinced when we left in that first meeting that we had it right, but we didn't have it right. Now, here's the question. What if that second interaction would have never happened? What if we wouldn't have had the opportunity to get to know them? Would our assessment of them change? No. Why would it? There's no evidence to change it. We met them. We had this brief interaction. We drew some conclusions from it, right or wrong. We drew the conclusions, and they're our conclusions. And because they're our conclusions, they must be right. And we go on our merry way, and we live the rest of our life with that assumption about this person. It's false. It's wrong. But until we have an occasion to interact with them, or until we get other information, maybe a best friend of theirs, we make some comment. Yeah, boy, he's sure proud of himself. Oh, you think so? No, not at all. Let me tell you about him. Well, that might change our mind. But if there's no evidence, if there's no other stimulus entered into this equation to alter our thinking, we're going to go on thinking what we thought. They're arrogant. They're conceited. They're pompous. There are people in education who have drawn some nonsensical conclusions about a variety of things. And we believe those things and we hold on to those things. And sometimes, even in the face of compelling evidence, we still hold on to them because, well, we have a bias. We don't like to admit it, but we all have a bias. We all have a bias. There are people in education who are fully convinced that standardized testing is the best way for us to gauge a student's progress. You know there are. And there are others who are equally convinced that it is among the poorest ways to accomplish that. There are people in education who are fully convinced that our profession is looked down upon. People kick us and they throw dirt on us and they hate us and they lambast us and we're victims. We're victims. We don't get enough respect. Maybe you're in that camp. Fully convinced that you are in an occupation that is so looked down upon by everybody in the world, and you believe that to be true. There are people in education who believe the only way that students can learn is we need to divide our students in the classroom into little smaller groups that are highly interactive. And if we don't do that, the students will never be engaged. They will never learn anything. There are people who believe that. There are people who believe that the administration, the district, the superintendent's office, they don't understand our problems, they don't know, they don't care. Fully convinced. And there are also people who believe that the union is our best friend. On and on and on it goes. I could mention a single word, or I could mention a number of ideas related to education, and it's highly likely that you have an opinion or some belief about these. And the mere mention of them would probably make your belief, your opinion, jump to the top of your mind, good or bad. Want to try it? Let's try it. Grades. Assignments. Suspensions. Curriculum. Textbooks, technology, principals, vice principals or assistant principals, guidance counselors, SAT, IQ, literacy, math, science, art, music, athletics, discipline, dress codes, parents, superintendents, school district, summer school, snow days, professional development, coworkers. Now, you've got some assumptions about every one of those. And I dare say some of your assumptions, some of your assertions are very deep-seated. You will not be remarkable if you continue to hang on to these things and let those things define your work and how you do your work. Now, the practical reality is we're human beings and we have biases and we have beliefs and we have convictions. I'm not asking you to check your convictions. I'm not asking you to abandon everything that you believe in. I'm asking you to abandon the nonsense, particularly the nonsense that's crippling your ability to be remarkable. I've coached a lot of people, and I can tell you that one of the things that really disturbs more careers in every industry is I'm a victim. I'm a victim. I'm fully convinced that my boss hates me. I'm fully convinced that the cards are stacked against me. I'm fully convinced that no matter what I do, I can't win for losing. I've sat in too many rooms across from too many people who expressed that position and who firmly believe that that's true. Let me just use that one as an illustration because there's so many things that we could discuss, and I don't want to make this too terribly long. You can't go through your life believing that that's true. For starters, I can tell you that the odds are people aren't thinking about you all that much. The odds are you're giving yourself a lot more credit. I chuckle when I hear teachers lament how we're tired of being the whipping post. We're tired of people, you know, putting down our profession and how noble and how high and how mighty we are and how we're victims. You know, get over yourself. Just get over yourself, because I got news for you. You're not on the top of everybody's mind. You're giving yourself way yonder too much credit, because none of us are thought about all the time, and none of us are given that place of priority, because everybody out there, you, me, everybody, we're interested in our own life. Well, but they put us down, and it's nonsense. It's nonsense. Does that define you? Does that define the job you do? Does that define, well, because that's how people look at me, then I'm going to devote my energy and my time to defending myself. Now, I'm here in Dallas, Texas. This is a pro sports town, and we hear interviews from professional athletes constantly. We are barraged with it. And one of the things that you always hear from some lame-brained, doesn't have enough self-respect athlete is the fact that the opponent didn't respect us. We felt like we were disrespected. Man, we hear it here in this town constantly. We hear the professional athlete whine constantly about how the opponents don't respect us, or opposing fans don't respect us, or the officials, they don't respect us. I have never, ever seen, I've only been here in Dallas for about 22 years. I've never, ever seen a professional athlete who took that position and who continued to whine about it. I've never seen that improve how people viewed that person. It's not happened that I've seen yet. The more you whine, the more you moan, the more you complain that, we'll all respect you now. Now we see how upset you are because we didn't respect. We'll respect you now. We're sorry. That doesn't happen. doesn't happen. All it does is compound things. Now they just get, if they were disrespected before, well, now they're respected even less because they've been a crybaby and they've been a whiner and a moaner and a complainer about it. No, we respect the people who just pick themselves up, go on about their job. You know who we respect? We respect those people who rise above the herd, those people who do extraordinary work. Oh, sure, there may be some who are jealous. There may be even some who are envious. And there may be some that hate us because of that. But, man, there's the way to go. Get rid of the nonsense that cripples your role in education. And think about this. If everybody would devote themselves to being remarkable, if everybody would devote themselves to getting rid of these idiotic falsehoods and delusions that stand in our way of doing remarkable work for the kids, don't you suppose that we could change things? Don't you suppose that there could be not just a minor, but a seismic shift? Do you think that's possible? Well, here we go. Disabusing the nonsense of the belief that we'll never change this. We'll never win this battle. We'll never morph and adapt to training our children in the ways that we need to train them so they're prepared for a better tomorrow. It'll never happen. My best advice, if that's part of the nonsense that you believe in, well, let me pose it as a question instead of advice. Why are you still here? Are you in a classroom? Are you teaching? Why? Now, I'm a competitive guy, but I'm a guy, if there's no hope of victory, I don't understand why fight. Why fight if there's no hope of victory? The whole point of playing, the whole point of doing battle is the hope of victory. Now, victory isn't always realized. Sometimes we're defeated. But does that mean that the fight's not worth fighting? Does that mean that the game's not worth playing? Does that mean that the enterprise is not worth chasing? Why pursue if you can't catch it? Why pursue if you can't accomplish it? How do you get up in the morning and do that? I couldn't. I can't. I happen to believe that education can be improved. I happen to believe that it can be improved, and I happen to believe, personally, this may be, well, here's the thing, and I'm going to end it with this illustration, because keep in mind, there's an important verb here, and that verb is crippling. We want to get rid of the nonsense that we believe that cripples our endeavor, that cripples what we're all interested in, education. I have this belief. I'm not going to get rid of this belief because I don't believe it's nonsense. And even if it is nonsense, it's not crippling, it's empowering. And here's the belief. I believe that one teacher can set about to change one student with influence, with persuasion, with teaching, with training, with caring, with sympathy, with holding them accountable. I believe that one teacher can make a difference in one kid's life. And I believe that the change that we're all looking for, the change that we seek, the improvement, well, we may all disagree about how to accomplish that, but I believe that one teacher can influence and persuade and change one student in a significant way to alter the course of that kid's life. And I believe by doing that, the work is remarkable, and I believe by doing that, change can be facilitated. You can call it the butterfly effect. You can call it anything you want. You've heard that. Somewhere on the other side of the planet, a butterfly flaps its wings and sets forth the movement of air. And by the time it reaches the other side of the globe, It's a hurricane. I believe that in your school, in your classroom, I believe that grassroots, starting from the ground and bubbling up from the grassroots, I believe change can happen for education in America. In fact, I'll go you one better. I believe that's the only way it's going to change. I don't happen to believe it's going to change from the top down. I happen to think that it's going to change from the bottom up. And I think once leaders, people in positions of authority, begin to see the seismic shift, once they see this thing happening, they're going to embrace it. And they are going to be responsible to facilitate it and to propel it and to accelerate it. Step one in being remarkable is disabuse yourself of the nonsense that you believe is crippling your career and crippling education in America. My name is Randy Cantrell. The website is Leaning Toward Wisdom. Please visit the website. Click that orange button over there on the side. Join the Leaning Toward Wisdom think tank. And until next time, I'll visit you with part two of this three-part series. Thanks. See you.